Hi, I'm Shabani, and I'm going to talk to you today about personality disorders, specifically Cluster A. Some learning objectives for this presentation include to understand the difference between personality trait and personality disorder, to learn to recognize personality disorders, to learn the characteristics and personality disorders in Cluster A, as well as to understand the general treatment options for Cluster A personality disorders. So let's first talk about personality trait versus personality disorder. What is the difference between these two? Personality consists of enduring patterns of perceiving, relating to, and thinking about the environment and oneself that are exhibited across numerous social and personal contexts. A personality disorder arises when personality traits are so inflexible and maladaptive across a wide range of situations that they cause significant distress and impairment of social, occupational, and role functioning. In addition, the thinking, displays of emotion, impulsivity, and interpersonal behavior of the individual must deviate markedly from the expectations of the individual's culture in order to qualify as a personality disorder. Patients with personality disorders can significantly strain the doctor-patient relationship. Clinicians frequently lack training in how to recognize and manage personality disorders. The estimated international prevalence of personality disorders is 6%. How do we recognize personality disorders? The clinician may feel angry, threatened, defensive, or incompetent, or may find it difficult to feel any emotional connection with the patient. Alternatively, the clinician may also find himself preoccupied with the patient without any specific event or attribute that would reasonably induce such involvement. Individuals with personality disorder often pose a challenge for clinicians, as features of their behavior may compromise care. Barriers to developing an effective doctor-patient alliance may arise related to distrust, irritability, poor communication skills, dependency, and excessive demands. Oftentimes, patients may have frequent mood swings, angry outbursts, anxiety sufficient to cause difficulty making friends, needing to be the center of attention, feeling of being widely cheated or taken advantage of, difficulty delaying gratification, not feeling there is anything wrong with their behavior, and blaming the world, externalizing their behaviors and feelings. The consistent presence of certain behaviors and traits, with onset in middle to late adolescence and continuing throughout adult life, are particularly suggestive of a personality disorder. Personality disorders are grouped into three main types. It can help to remember the mnemonic weird, wild, and worried for their respective grouping. Weird refers to Cluster A group of odd or eccentric, inability to develop meaningful social relationships. No psychosis is associated with this group. However, there is some genetic association with schizophrenia. Wild refers to the group B cluster of dramatic, emotional, or erratic. There is some genetic association with mood disorders and substance abuse. And worried refers to the cluster C group of anxious or fearful. There is some genetic association with anxiety disorders here. In this presentation, I will focus on the types of personality disorders within Cluster A. Cluster A disorders include the following types: paranoid, schizoid, and schizotypal. This is a categorical approach, however. An individual diagnosed with a personality disorder may have an additional personality disorder from a different cluster. Now I will discuss each type in more detail. The key characteristics of an individual with paranoid personality disorder typically suspects without much basis that others are exploiting or deceiving him or her, and is often preoccupied with unjustified doubts about the loyalty or trustworthiness of friends or associates. Typically, they're also reluctant to confide in others because of unwarranted fear that the information will be used somehow maliciously against him or her. They typically read hidden, demeaning, or threatening meanings into benign remarks or events. Persistently bears grudges, unforgiving of insults, injuries, or slights, perceives attacks on his or her character or reputation that are not typically apparent to other people, and are quick to react angrily or counterattack. They have recurrent suspicions, pretty much without justification, regarding the fidelity of a spouse or a sexual partner. A schizotypal patient have social and interpersonal deficits marked by acute discomfort with and reduced capacity for close relationships, as well as by cognitive or perceptual distortions and eccentric behavior. This is typically characterized by odd beliefs or magical thinking, ideas of reference, which is a symptom in which patients think that things completely disconnected from him or her are influencing him or her or conveying some type of message. They typically have unusual perceptual experiences, including bodily illusions, odd thinking and speech. They have suspiciousness or paranoid ideations. They might have an inappropriate or constricted affect, behavior or appearance that is odd, eccentric, or peculiar, and they lack close friends or confidants other than their first-degree relatives, typically. They have excessive social anxiety that doesn't diminish with familiarity and tends to be associated with paranoid fears rather than negative judgments about themselves. The key characteristics of schizoid personality disorder includes detachment from social relationships and a restricted range of expression of emotions, typically in interpersonal settings. And this is seen by the fact that they typically don't desire nor enjoy close relationships, including being part of a family. They almost always choose solitary activities over group activities. They have little, if any, interest in having sexual experiences with another person. They take pleasure in very few activities. They lack close friends or confidence other than first-degree relatives. They appear indifferent to praise or criticism. They typically can show emotional coldness, detachment, or a flattened affectivity. So now let's talk about treatment. There's no specific medications that are approved by the Food and Drug Administration of the U.S. for the treatment of personality disorders. However, patients who present with personality difficulties not infrequently have other psychiatric disorders, including depression and substance abuse, that should be addressed with appropriate pharmacological treatment. Some studies suggest that it's more useful to target specific behavioral difficulties, for example, self-destructiveness, impulsivity, anger control, through psychodynamic therapy. Now, psychopharmacotherapy, such as low-dose antipsychotics, have shown some benefit in schizotypal personality disorder. SSRIs are often thought of as a first-line medical therapy for some personality disorders. Mood stabilizers may help stabilize the mood and reduce irritability or aggression. So in summary, a personality disorder arises When an individual's personality traits are so inflexible and maladaptive across a wide range of situations that they cause significant impairment and distress. Personality disorders are defined by specific DSM-IV criteria, and specific types of personality disorders are grouped in three clusters and defined separately. Cluster A personality disorders are grouped into the odd and eccentric group, which is composed of paranoid, schizoid, and schizotypal. Treatment can include both therapy and pharmacotherapy. Patients with personality disorder may benefit from early referral to a mental health professional. Patients with personality disorders are at increased risk for adverse outcomes related to physical trauma, suicide, substance abuse, and concurrent psychiatric disorders. Additionally, patients often have difficulty understanding their condition and establishing rapport with their clinician. Here are some key references from this presentation. Thank you.